right, we are live. Thank you everybody for joining us. My name is Marie Claire, and I'm joining Yafin via intercom. I'm Shleza's social media manager, and I'm just facilitating this live lecture today, and I'm really, really happy to be here with all of you. Thank you to Elise for getting all these people together, all these great writers together. We're so excited to have Yafin here to answer all of our questions and also give us this amazing lecture about gender appropriate saddle fit. So thank you, Yafin, for joining us. We're so excited about this.
Yes, this is one of my favorite topics because, quite frankly, as an instructor and writer myself, I always was frustrated when my students didn't do what I said when it came to how to implement the seat properly. And only after I made already thousands and thousands of saddles, I met a gynecologist who took himself out of the office, brought two plastic pelvises to share with me how important it is to really understand the anatomical difference between a male and female pelvis. Because he said to me that there's a lot of female riders who have chronic bladder and kidney infection from a saddle. Of course, I didn't believe it. Well, I never heard about it. And then I thought about it. Yes, my mom had a tack shop. And I know when people came in the shop, they didn't tell her, well, I'm hurting right there. It's rubbing here. It's kind of very uncomfortable situation, especially when most people who make saddles are guys. Male make saddles. And when you make a saddle for a female, and you just met somebody, it's something you don't talk right away about it. But when I find out how much difference there is between the male and female pelvis, then a light bulb came on to me. And I said, wow, since I was a little boy, it was hammered into me. The most important aid is your seat. Your seat is how you implement the weight to the horse and how you pivot your pelvis. So given that and everything I learned when I went through my apprenticeship years for 3 years, and then I had to do several years as a journeyman before I was allowed to apply to the school to become a certified master saddler. And then you make a saddle in front of masters. And most of the time, it's all guys. So in the riding world, I took riding lessons from guys. And then in the late 70s, more riders were females. And I had a lot of students. And again, I taught what somebody told me how to implement the most important aid, the seat. I built saddles like I was told by my master saddler, and he was told from his master saddler. And of course, it blew my mind when I met this gynecologist who showed me these two different pelvises. And what I decided to do after I came to North America, I started this trade in, well, let me think, 1978. Wow, 42 years ago. And then, as I said, my mom had a tack shop, and we had a saddlery as well as there as well. But when I came to North America with my wife, we established a company called Schles Saddlery Service. So Schleser is a manufacturing company, but I met so many incredible good riders, doctors, like I said, the gynecologist, as well as medical veterinarians who says, you know, I think the horse is sore because of the way the rider rides. And I always remember one of my masters told me a very famous book out of the early 1900s was written by Udo Berger. And the book was called The Rider Forms the Horse. And as I said, the seat is the most important part. And then I thought, wouldn't it be cool if more people will know about saddle fitting? And then I thought, wow, I can only do it if I associate myself. So we created in 2006 an academy, what called Saddle Fit for Life. And we work with other manufacturers and saddle fitters together who follow the philosophy of Saddle Fit for Life. So Saddle Fit for Life, it's a global network from professionals who dedicated to protect horse and rider from long-term damage been caused by saddles and tack. Now, my company, Schleser, we make saddles for Western, for event riders, for pleasure riders, jumper riders, and we make a saddle And we are proud to really say fit is everything. And if you as a rider understand a young horse or a horse who goes long distance in as an endurance horse, as a pleasure horse, or as a jumper, you need to train the horse to get the strong back to carry the rider for the height of the jumps or the eventing or the dressage. So training and getting the horse fit requires, of course, that the saddle is adjustable. So in the first years, when you make these saddles for thousands and thousands of saddles, we focus on the horse 100%. And then, of course, as I said already, the gynecologist blew my mind when he came and said that a majority of the riders have chronic bladder and kidney infection from a bad fitting saddles. And then everything turned upside down. I had a choice. I could have been like an ostrich or the bird who puts his head in the sand and pretend I don't see anything and continue the way I'm being taught for the last thousands of years, how men always were taught by men. Or I could actually say, wait a minute, something actually changed. The majority of the riders are now women. Even on my picture, what I have up right now, you see one guy, okay, the Western rider. But in the majority of the riders are really women, even in Western. So over the years, we've seen all kinds of sizes and our fun words, we always say tall or small, we fit them all. And just like in the picture, the majority of our riders, Western or English, are women. And sometimes you have a tiny rider with an extremely big horse, or you have a rather tall rider on a smaller horse. And how do we get the saddle to sit quiet so it doesn't hurt the rider and the horse? We need to follow the masters who kept saying the most important aid is your seat. Now look at this little kid, how far her legs are forward, because that wide horse, she literally sits there like and does a split. So when we look at how our legs and our knees, our hips work, they don't bend through the largest bone of our body, which is your femur. So we need to understand a little bit about anatomy of the rider itself. So then I find this quote from a Spanish director who says, it is of the utmost importance not to cause the pupil any discomfort. With a cramped posture, it's impossible to achieve a pliable seat. It's impossible to achieve a pliable seat. What's a pliable seat? Oh, that sounds familiar. It sounds like what my instructors were pounding into me. Be effective with the seat, be soft with the seat, but keep your seat in the saddle. Pliable seat, I got it. Without a pliable seat, it is not possible to achieve oscillation in the horse's back. Oscillation, the horse's swing. Unless you, of course, don't want the horses to swing, want to be rigid and hollow and just be a leg mover and throw his legs, but a good rider gets the horses back to swing. And as we learned, or I learned, and hopefully most of you learned, a horse needs to swing his back to get his haunches underneath, to get light in the front. So what is he saying here? And if back cannot oscillate, if the back cannot swing, the horse will suffer pain. So, and the horse cannot collect, which means he cannot come off the forehand. So all these years I made saddles and fitted saddles for the horses, I couldn't believe I neglected the most important part, fitting the rider. So what I wanted to do, I wanted to look at how these two skeletons, the skeleton of a horse, which is horizontal, and the skeleton of the rider, which is vertical. How do these two come together? The piece in the middle, what we call saddles, that's what I've been trained on. That's where I have my master's, and that's what I teach since 2006. Worldwide. I'm also very happy and proud and excited that we do this now in many universities and becomes part of the curriculum in one or the other courses the students can take. So it's, in my opinion, very important. So let's go back to what the Spanish riding director says. If the saddle does not fit the rider, the saddle and the rider will hurt the horse unintentionally. I believe that. I believe that most people out there don't go, let's hurt the horse. Let's go and let's see how we can hurt the horse. No. most people own a horse here. Yeah, I know there's a lot of professional who have horses who come in and they need to train and they can't fit every saddle to every horse. I get all this. But if the saddle fits the rider first, he or she has a pliable seat. And what I learned through all these years, through all these videos, through all those masters, as a coach, as a trainer, as a judge, as a master saddler, and from gynecologists and veterinarian, osteopath, and people who specialize in biomechanics. Jillian Kreinberg from Texas, unbelievable. Go on the Schleser website, we have lots of videos on that. As well as from Gerd Heuschmidt, my personal hero. He is an incredible rider, also an incredible veterinarian. Many, many, many videos on that. So if we understand the rider has to fit, and as I said, most people adore and love their horses. They want their horse, nothing else the best. So they care, they look after them, they feed them. And when you ride, you want to become one with the horse. And isn't that what we always want? We want to become one with them. So then let's look at what the experts say. Listen, this guy here, Dr. James Worsen, medical doctor, writes a book about the pain-free back for rider. That's the second time now that I read and heard that you can actually get chronic bladder and kidney infection when you ride in the gender-appropriate, non-appropriate saddle. So if you ride in the male saddle as a female, you will have problems in your back. So luckily for me, because I'm just a rider, a trainer, a judge, a master saddler, I not went to university and studied the anatomy and biomechanics and physiology of the anatomy of the rider. So here we have a book, black and white, and we see very clear what's going on. So if the female and the male have different curvature, just alone that means that they ride to the same rules. What other sport is there really where men and women compete? Come up with one. I can't come up with one. But here we have a discipline, an Olympic discipline, where women and male compete together. So when we look at this, here's my daughter with her former boyfriend, both very tall, very slim. And the gynecologist said to me, why don't you do what the dentists do? I said, what do the dentists do? They take a mold of people's gum to make the proper whatever, braces. And I said, how do you make a mold of a rider's butt? So we came up with a system what works very well. And here we have two people sitting like a rider, not sitting on the toilet or sitting on the chair, because we want to sit the way we stand. And like all of you who have learned how to ride, riding is kind of like a Tai Chi stand, except you don't stand on your feet, you sit on your seat bones. So once we took the riders off, you know, so let's see what happens first. Look how, I don't know if my mouse, yeah, it will go. See how this seat bones of a guy hits first, and then the pubic symphysis, let me get a pelvis here. So you're looking at the pelvis from the side. This is the pubic symphysis, and this is the pubic branches. So on the guy, they go straight up, okay? On the female, so here you can see how the back, that has to be level. You can see here on the top of this slide, this has to be level. See how the vertebrae don't tilt this way or that. So if I hold this level, you see the pubic branches here going actually down, okay? And the first thing what impacts on the saddle, it's actually the front bone, the pubic symphysis. And here, what is so important to sit on your seat bones, back here, the guy does. Now, I didn't make up the rule. I also don't believe that nature intended humans to sit on animals. But people made saddles so that the weight of the rider is distributed over a longer area. The horse can carry longer weight, heavy weight, and the rider gets support in the spine so he can feather with the back wet swings. And that's what they're talking about in the Spanish riding school. If you want to have a horse what has a swinging back oscillation, then you got to have a pliable seat, pivoting. So needless to say that this here, piece of cake for this guy, because he pivots over the seat bone. But if it's a female sitting in the saddle, in a male saddle, the first you're going to hit is the crotch, sorry, the pubic symphysis, then your pubic branches, right here on the side, that's where your underwear line goes through. There is hardly anybody, no guys. We as the male riders, our underwear line never is our issue. Many, many trainers, including myself, every time my students, my female riders said, that rubs me on the underwear, I thought they made it up. I said, get off the saddle, let me try riding on that saddle. I will see, I have underwear on, if you are right or not. And of course I says, you're not right because I don't feel it. Duh, the reason why I didn't feel it is because my pubic symphysis is much higher. My pubic branches is much higher. So you can see in the slide here, no issue for the guys. The girls on the female pelvis, on the female pelvis on the male saddle, there's the problem. Here's the issue when you see it, when I put a pelvis on a saddle. You can see the seat bones here on the male. He can pivot nicely, pubic branches free, pubic symphysis free. And I'm sorry, I know this is a worldwide web, but I'm gonna say it anyway. We can put our tidy whities on and we can put our stuff left or right. ladies, you can't do it. You can put tight whities on, but you can't put your parts left or right. So when you sit on a saddle that already attacks your front bone and your side bone where your underwear is, and then also in the crotch. Yes, I said crotch, because now finally I understood when the gynecologist and Dr. James Worsen says it gives you chronic bladder and kidney infection. If you ride in the saddle, what's a male saddle and you're a female? Look how this is hitting right there where the underwear line is and right there on the crotch. So when we ask ourselves, let's look at the cast. The male, you see the two seat bones in the back, nice and narrow. Surprise, a female has a wider seat bone. Why are the seat bones much wider? You're looking at the pelvis of a female in the front. You're looking at the pelvis from the bottom. Much wider. So I can easily put my whole fist in here and go wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. So on the male, the seat bones, oh, this guy has a broken pelvis. So anyway, you can see already the seat bones are much closer together, way, way closer. But interesting in this cast, you can see this impact here. That's what I was talking about the whole time. That's the pubic symphysis on a female. So how do you protect that? Well, you can say, oh, I'm tough, I'm gonna learn how to ride. Well, how are you gonna ride if the first impact is your pubic symphysis or your underwear or your soft parts? You wanna ride like the lady on the right side, okay? Because what you're gonna do, you pivot your pelvis back, your leg goes forward. Now, where's your shoulder, hips, and heel? Where's your pliable seat? Not at all. The back of the saddle is shallower, lower. That's what guys like. And there's no leather behind the leg. If you sit in a saddle made for a female, surprise, there's actually saddles made for women. Just like you can go in the store and you can buy underwear for male and underwear for women. You can buy jeans for male and you can buy jeans for females. Same thing for saddles. And everybody says, I never heard about it. Well, of course not, because for thousands of years, it was normal that the guy made a saddle for a guy and guys were always riding. But not until the 78, late 70s, is where the majority of the riders become women. And now that we have so much research and technology and science and not saddle makers, because we rather make your male saddles and keep selling you saddle after saddle after saddle after saddles, because ladies, I guarantee you, you either give up riding, keep buying new horses, and you keep buying saddles. If you're sick and tired of deforming your body, hurting or crippling yourself, how the doctors say it, then listen up. You can actually get a saddle for yourself, a female saddle, just like the one on the left. So if we're going to go a little further, if you keep riding on it, because sitting is one thing, but if the horse starts moving, walk, trot, canter, all of a sudden there's all this friction. And of course, you want to brace yourself and you lean back, okay? Now you're really in the bad chair seat. And look at the toes out and all that stuff. Okay, so you are driving the horses back down and you are not having a pliable seat. We have done this study in England at University of Cambridge. This was a mechanical horse. We fitted his saddle, was fitted perfect. We put a male on the male saddle and the pressure was nice and even and soft. We put a female rider, same height, same weight, everything. And wouldn't you know, all the pressure was in the back of the saddle, just like you see in this picture here. Okay, so ladies, I'm not saying you can't ride, but I'm saying you cannot ride in a male saddle. Just like every male, there's not a single male who can ride rodeo or any kind of riding in female jeans. Not gonna happen. He's gonna squish, he might speak very high all of a sudden, but he's gonna be super uncomfortable. And that's not riding. He's gonna be cramped and protecting himself because that's gonna hurt extraordinary if he can't shift his stuff left or right. So that's just jeans. What about you ladies who are riding in metal reinforced leather, plastic tree, wooden tree, adapt tree, whatever. All right, so let's have a look at the next slide here. I think this side shows it really nice because on the guy you can see shoulder, hips and heels, and you have four curves as a male or female, but we have a longer tailbone and our butt cheek is closer to the horse. Right here you can see the butt cheek because our lower back is straighter. That was what I was showing earlier from Dr. James Worson when he puts on the front page, the book. Let me show you the book again here. Okay, he puts on the front page the two different spines. So that's what I'm talking about here. This is the slide. I really want you to pay attention. So these two different slides, you will see the girl has also four curve, but you have as a lady more lordosis. You have more curvature here. You have a shorter tailbone because a guy doesn't have a burst channel, right? So he does not need to have the extra wide seat bone and the extra space. Again, I don't make up these rules. I was just as, whoa, that makes totally sense when somebody explained that to me, the gynecologist. So the ladies has a much shorter tailbone, more curvature in the lower back. So you can see as a lady, in order to achieve a pliable seat, and ride like the old master said, you got to have your four curves to sit soft. And here comes the word again, have a pliable seat. Pliable seat means you got to be moving back and forth, right? So if you get that neutral position, neutral again, that this is level, then you can only tilt your pelvis back and forth. One of the professors I met in Germany who wrote over 35 books, his name was Eckhard Meiners. He invented a chair with pivots and you can practice your pelvis, your movement. But if you have a saddle what doesn't support you in the back, okay, you see there's all this gap here, you cannot ride soft. As a matter of fact, you can be a rider who weighs 125 kilos, that's 250 pounds, and ride half of their weight. That means like 125 pounds or 62 kilos. If you are a lady and you weigh, let's say 80 or 70 kilos, that's 140 pounds, you can ride 70 pound rider, very light, or you can ride twice your weight. You're riding like a jackhammer, pounding in the horse's back, and all of a sudden your weight becomes double. And that, again, I can't keep enough, restate that statement. If the rider doesn't have a pliable seat, the horse will suffer, okay? So you have a choice, no matter how much you weigh, to ride twice your weight or half your weight. And as an example, if you don't believe me or I don't understand what I'm trying to say, jump from the stairs, maybe the first flight, with your knees bending when you land and with your knees straight. Disc will blow. Okay, you will never do that. You do that once and you hurt your knees, your joints, your fillings falling out of your teeth. So of course nobody does that. But why do we do it to the horse? So if we are sitting on the saddle, we got to look at the difference here between male and female pelvis. You see the male, the longer tailbone, his hip socket comes straight down and the tailbone's much shorter. And here's something interesting. The hip socket is further forward and in a different angle of the female. I did not know this. after my 3 years journeyman, after my many years as a, 3 years apprentice, many years as a journey, and even as a master, I never knew this. So now that this is publicly available, now we can see, I apologize for the noise, we have carpenters in the house and they promised me not to do any sawing or drilling. So anyway, hopefully it's not too many. So here we have now the next slide where you can see a pelvis, which is not in the neutral position. Here is where you would sit as a rodeo rider, as a bullfighter. But you see the dotted line on top. Let's see the pen, for example, okay? If I put the pen on top of the vertebrae, that simulates a red dotted line. So that is the pelvis, what is leaning back. That means this rider will put axis pressure twice the weight in the horse's back. If the pelvis would be level, like the green line, like my pen, okay, then the rider is what we call in the neutral position. You can now have a pliable seat. So many, many tests have been made. There are little jackets like this, where you can see the rider's shoulders, spine, there's gait analysis, there's computerized saddle pads, there's heart monitors, and we've shown this every time. A guy who's a mediocre beginner rider rides always better bareback, I'm sorry ladies, than a Grand Prix dressage rider, female rider. She cannot ride bareback on the horse. Now that's a pretty brutal statement I made here, but let me explain why, okay? Think about a horse, right here. Most horses have a withers, okay? And at the base of the withers, Caprilli has taught us, it's an Italian cavalry officer who came up with the 2 point. Where's the baseline? Where do we sit? Okay, do we want to sit in the middle of the back where the horse is bouncy? That would be here where my mouse is. Or do we want to sit on top of the withers? Of course not. There is a spot, if this is the horse's back swinging, right at the base of the withers. All the bullfighters, all the rodeo riders, all the bareback riders sit there. So at the front of the withers, what do we got? Okay, if I'm using this here as the top line, okay, there's the withers. Okay, so if I want to sit at the front of the withers, what comes up in front with the bone? What goes first down on the rider, on the female rider? I've shown you books, I've shown you diagrams, I've done lots of body casts. So we know what comes first down. Ladies, it's your pubic symphysis. So right now you can see the top of the pelvis is pretty neutral, like the green line. If you will sit on the right spot on the horse, you will hit that pubic symphysis, then your crotch, then the underwear line. By the time you sit on your seat bones, look how you're leaning back, just like the red line. And I'm not saying that because I'm sexist or I don't like ladies. That's quite the opposite. I love ladies. What I'm saying is that anatomical, it is impossible, and we've shown it with several tests. You cannot have a pliable seat, not a perpendicular line. And if you don't have that, the horse will suffer pain. Not my words. Something what has been taught since over 400 years. So if you lean then forward to be with your ball of the foot, what has that to do? Why do I lean forward? Every rider will do it. Very simple. Because when you learn how to walk, okay, as a little baby, every human, when they learn to walk, they run on tippy toes. If you look at the foot, the ball of the foot, right, that's where you land. And for all these years, for hundreds and hundreds of years, when people taught riding, shoulder, hips, and heels will equal sternum to ball of the foot. If a jockey gallops on the horse, his butt is back, his head is forward, but his sternum is over the foot of the stirrup. A hunter rider, a jumper rider, a dressage rider, you always imbalance if your sternum and your ball of the foot align. Okay? So if you sit now bareback on the saddle or the horse and the pelvis makes you slouch, your leg goes forward, you're going to lean forward. If you ride as a lady in a female saddle, you're going to avoid the peak of the seed, because that's the first thing saddle makers learn when they form the seed. They learn from their master to make the foam where my fingernails are nice and pointy. And of course, I'm raised my hand and says, "Master, why are we making the foam pointy?" And then my master saddler said to me, "I thought you're a rider." I felt pretty stupid, but my dad always taught me the person who knows the how will always follow the person who knows the why. I needed to understand why we make saddles like this. And you know what the master saddler's answer was? The reason why we make the foam pointy is so that the male's part can go left or right side, so you never fall on top of your parts. Made complete sense to me. But you think I actually thought a little further to actually say, but wait a minute, aren't the most riders ladies? So why would a woman want to ride on the rooftop? Not at all. So after I talked to the gynecologist, and after I seen all this evidence, if it's from the horse, how much better the horse goes when the lady has a pliable seat as well. After I saw the less damage on the horse's back, after I saw how many much happier the riders were, we patented a tree, what we call the adapt tree. Adapts to the biomechanic movement of the horse into the different sizes. But we also have what we call a CC crotch comfort. So what we did, just like you see in the bicycle seat, right in the seat, there is a cutout. Okay, so for the female saddle, it's completely the opposite. We cut the roof and we have a collapsed roof right underneath the crotch. So if you do not do it, you will fall back. And then what happens, look at your disc, okay? Your disc will slip. This is super painful. And many, many riders, top riders, female riders, have been operated on L4, L5. The healthy disc is in the center, but wow, boy, when it's slip disc, that's super painful because it goes into the nerves, okay? Collapsed disc, well, you're not walking at that stage. So definitely is something you want to avoid. I cannot tell you enough, these are not my inventions. I didn't invent one human with a birth channel, the other one without birth channel. I didn't invent the horseback riding. I just adopted and learned what was passed from my master, and his master told his master. So now that majority of my clients who are riding, I see it everywhere. No matter in what part of the world, if it's in Russia, in Asia, in Europe, in North America, South America, South Africa, anywhere in the world, the majority of the riders are ladies. So if that makes any sense to you, why would you want, like this lady, avoid the crotch pain, lean back, lift the heels, look at that here, right? And then she's just pushing her butt back, okay? A guy likes to sit on the rooftop because the seat bone hits and there's this gap there in the crotch. And on the lady, you see her seat bones are much wider. Surprise! Okay. Yeah, but I'm a petite lady. No matter if you're very tiny or if you're very big, female have the ability to bear a child. Yes, some women have wider pelvises, some have shorter one. But in general, if we generalize for once, one thing, there's two different gender, male and female. And that one pelvis with long tail bone, narrow seat bone, high pubic symphysis, they don't have a chance to ever bear a child. Where a lady, yes. So if we go on and have a look at the different structure in the hips, you will see right here on the ladies where this area is much wider on the ladies. We all know it. Ladies have wider hips than guys. And the femur is cone-shaped, which means it comes from the outside into the knee and from the knee down to the foot. And on the guy, the femur goes straight to the knee, from the knee straight to the foot. And I don't care if you have skinny thighs or stronger thighs. On a guy, right around here, okay, that's where we measure, when we measure for a saddle, at the widest part of the thigh, the guy always has an oval thigh. I don't care for ladies, if you are a skinny thigh or stronger thigh, your shape is always round, okay? So that has something to do how your muscle sits on your upper leg, okay? Your thigh is round as a lady, males are oval. Now I want you to pay attention to this area, right between the upper inner thigh, at the height of her thumb, Okay, so not, or maybe go a little lower where the fingertips are. Okay, in that area, look how small that space is. And if you go right across, it's much more space. Okay, that area, we call it the twist. When I buy a saddle from a tree maker, the tree maker wants to know how long is the tree, how wide is the tree width here, how narrow or wide we want the angle, how narrow or wide you want the seat width, and how narrow or wide you want the twist. See the webbing here? That's already done by a saddler. The company where we buy trees from, the tree company, they have a beetroot laminated tree most of the time. I mean, there's five different types of tree. Maybe we have a different webinar once just on trees, because I find that super, super interesting as well. But this here, most common are the old trees. So this is the beetroot laminated, and this is all formed. Here again, the tree width, here the angle, the tree length. Okay, that's, sorry, the tree length. This is the seat length. And then you can see there's different cutouts in the front. This is the seat width. And again, this is the twist. There's no leather on yet. And that area would be in this area from the rider. And in the past, most saddles and watch much, much wider there. And when a lady rides on a male saddle that has a wider twist, that will cause humongous problem, not just to your hip sockets. Right here you see the hip socket, but look at this nerve. That's a sciatic nerve. This sciatic nerve runs parallel there. Sometimes people come to me and says, can you fit me for a saddle because I'm sick and tired that my foot falls asleep? I says, what? I never heard a rider where the foot falls asleep or tingles. And sometimes the riders get off and they can't land when they can't stand. Their pain in the hip is tremendous. We have done a TV show on West Coast in California where we shown what the typical signs of a rider's pain is, you know, and that is when you pinch your nerves. Very painful. So if you have a slouched pelvis because you're protecting yourself from the front of the saddle, or now on top you're sitting on the saddle that's way too wide, where? Between your upper inner thigh. One more time. That's right there where her fingertips end. Right there. That is much smaller than on the guy. Why? The femur is different shape. The muscle is different. And we have different parts in the crotch. So now, if we fit this for the rider, but we put all the riders in the same twist, the most common long-term damage for the rider is hip, or also known as joint damage. So number one is chronic bladder and kidney infection. Number two, it's disc. L4, L5 is a huge issue. And the third most common one is the hip and knee issue. So when the hip, when the twist is too wide, and again, the saddle here, that's where the lady's fingertips ended, right? So that would be, her leg would be probably in this area. That's the area what I showed you on the tree. So when that is too wide, that will put you in this position. Because you can say, oh, I can really grip with my thigh. I'm gonna force it back there. Oh, my instructor actually takes the muscle and he rolls the thigh back and puts it there. You know why I did this to all my students too? And many, many instructors still do it? Because we know that's how it feels on me. But I can't go against nature, totally ignore nature's law, and try to rotate a lady's muscle what's on the inside while mine's on the back. So if you have an ignorant client, sorry, ignorant instructor, you might want to give him a book where the muscles on the lady versus on the male sits, so they don't start dislocating your muscles. It's kind of like somebody goes to a guy and says, I want your biceps laying on the right side, on the side of your arm, not on top of the arm. This is how ridiculous this is. Now, you see how I'm talking? I was just like that because I didn't know what I didn't know. And that's why I formed Saddle Fit for Life. I wanted an educational arm out of Saddle Schleser, who makes saddles and sells saddles, and, well, But I wanted to really say there are so many horses what are hurting. I can't fit everybody and sell everybody or make everybody a saddle. But I'm really, really sad how many horses and human riding in the wrong equipment because they don't know, right? There are people who are rolling their upper thighs and trying to put this right. The reason why their knee goes out and the toe goes out, look how this toe goes out, okay? If this lady is post-trotting, she would post-trot and bend her knee not in the same direction as her foot. If she would, she would do plié on the horse. A Latin, a word from ballet, when you bend down in your knees and your knees go to the outside. No rider wants that, right? So we always learn toes forward, heels down, you know? So it's impossible when between your longest bone, your femur, the reinforced wood metal reinforced is too wide and it pops your hips and your knees. So if you say, okay, I'm really tired of that and I don't want to be sore in my lower back, what do I really need to know? Let's go back to what I said, sternum to sternum, okay? If you have the ball of the foot in line with the sternum, you are balanced. You can run on tippy toes like you learned when you were a baby. Then, when you put your sternum over the horse's sternum, you're sitting over the sweet spot of the horse like Caprilli taught us, decades ago. We sit quiet and go with the movement of the horse. If, here comes the big if, you have a pliable seat, which means your four curves in your body becomes the shock absorption and you're soft in your hip, knees, and ankle, okay? That is a must. Now that we learned there's such a difference, not my opinion, this is how nature made, this is why I always say, you know, you can go against nature or you can respect the law of nature, you know? Ignore what you just learned, this is nature, right? This is not somebody gynecologist idea or Dr. James Watson idea or my idea, that's nature's idea that one of the species, the females, have a chance to bear a child. So if that's so different and we ignore that, while here you see us, let me show you what that picture looks like. This is from the front. Now you're looking from the back, from the bottom. This is the seat bones. And as a saddle maker, you have a saddle that has a foam. This is the foam. And you want that foam not too wide. Otherwise, you feel like you're sitting on the tabletop. But if your seat bones are wider than your seat, okay, many ladies say, I don't have a seat bone. I have never felt my seat bones. Well, most likely because you're sitting over this foam. Okay, and what do you do as a lady? Look what she does. She pushes herself all the way back in the saddle. Why? Because if you go further back to the saddle, the seat gets wider. But you don't want to sit there because that is a very, very, very vulnerable area for the horse. And again, where does your toes and your sternum align? Miles apart, that horse does a quick turn, tries to canter, and you will fall off. No, I'm not falling off. I'm pinching with my knees and I'm holding tight to my saddle. You're riding with twice your weight. Twice your weight. Well, I only weigh 125 pounds. You're riding like 250 pounds. Jackhammer. Because you can't, again, don't respect law of nature. You cannot be soft to the horse. This for me was so eye-opening when I work with people such as Dr. Joyce Harmon, Sue Dyson, Dr. Gerd Heuschmann. I mean, the list goes on and on and on, who explained that to me from the anatomy, biomechanic, physiology from horse and rider. And then on top, we have tools like the heart monitor, gait analysis, pressure pads, all that makes sense. So I'm here today for you to show you what I learned over the last 42 years so you don't make the mistakes I did to my students and you're not hurting yourself or your horse unintentionally. Stirrup bars, this is this little unit here, okay? It's very important that it hangs in the right direction, in the right spot, okay? It has to hang in the right spot. Otherwise, it's like a pendulum. If I'm using this tape measure here and I hang it on something, let's hang it on a stirrup bar. The stirrup bar on the saddle is here. Okay, so if I hang that stirrup leather, or in this case, the tape, and your foot wants to be here, nicely underneath you, but as soon as you put the weight in it, what do you think the stirrup leather will do? Pulls your leg forward or back. This little guy, 1, 2, 3 rivets. It is so important that it hangs in the right spot. Law of nature, physics, but nobody explains it to you. Of course, you don't know, and you're buying saddle after saddle. So if you understand that there is such a difference, then you also understand that many, many clinicians are absolutely crazy when they say stuff like 95% of riders hang in the horse's mouth. That's a pretty rough statement. Okay, so good hands is the secret of riding. I learned that too. The most important aid is your seat, not your hands. Why was that taught? Because back in the old days, the soldier had to wield a weapon. You know, we had other stuff to do with it. We control our horse with the command center. It's between your upper thigh to your belly button. But the most centered part there is your pelvis. They bounce around because they don't have a pliable seat. Then you're in trouble. Or they don't have an independent seat. Means they can't give the aid to the horse without falling one side or the other. Now, is that really, really that most people don't want to learn how to ride, or most people are so bad compared to the old days? I like to beg the differ. I say we are most sophisticated. We had so much power in our hands, the smartphones, and we learn and we know and understand so much more than ever before in humankind. So I think the majority of the people want to do good, but not in the as a female in the male style. You can't. You can't go against nature. If you do, well, you deform your back. So what is the solution? The solution is there are 9 different features on the saddle. We talked about number 8, the crotch hole. That area here, for the male, we want it pointy. Female, we want flat. We talked about the seaming here in the front, that seaming in the front. Okay, so we want that seaming nice and far away. That's way on top. That's not where the lady had her fingertips. Between the upper inner thigh, that's where number 3 is. That's the twist. We want to start what's nice and small there for the lady. Okay, right back here where number 2 is, that's the seat width. Well, obviously, the person who has a childbearing pelvis or pelvis with a birth channel wants it wider than a male who doesn't have one. Number 5 is how the foam is supported. Remember how I showed you from the side? The guy has a straighter back, longer tailbone, and with the straighter back, this gluteus maximus sits closer to the horse. With the lady who has more curvature in the lower back, the gluteus maximus sits higher, shorter tailbone, so she needs more foam here on number 5. Okay, so you can see it's completely the opposite from one to the other. So when we have a quick recap of what I just said.
I design differently for men as for women. A male saddle has a narrow seat width, a narrow waist, and a wide twist. This saddle is designed for a woman. Soft seat, crotch comfort, a narrow twist, wider seam.
So that wider seam right there, that is because you have your pubic symphysis and your pubic branches flat going to the front. This is where your underwear line. If you rub that, it will hurt. Now that seam, this is not where your upper inner thigh is. Your upper inner thigh is down in this area. So many people to this day, even saddlers or saddle fitters in quotation, think what I'm pointing there is the twist. You talk to every instructor, every Olympic rider. If you ask, what's the twist? Oh, the twist is how close contact I get to my horse. Where? On your crotch? On your upper inner thigh, not on the top. So the twist is what's between your upper inner thigh, and the seaming is so your underwear line as the lady doesn't rub. Okay, so if we to the next slides here. This one here is a summary. We have the horizontal spine of the horse, walk, trot, and canter, and then the vertical spine of the rider. If they move together, that's what it's all about. Then we have, as I said before, the lady has more lower dorsal curve, more curvature in the lower back, tailbone is shorter, existing, having a birth channel, and the pelvis axis is more forward. What is the pelvis axis? That means the center of your hip socket on a male is smack in the center. Okay, it's very easy for males to balance themselves on seat bones because when you're standing, your weight's on your feet. Those feet are attached to legs, and these legs sit in the pelvis in the hip socket. So you know the hip socket is in the center, pretty easy to stand. On the lady, the hip sockets are further forward, which means the pelvis axis on the lady is more forward. That means why you cannot ride bareback in a pliable seat if you're a lady, because you will always fall down. You will always fall down because the pelvis axis move forward. Again, humans are not meant to, by nature, sit on the animal and ride. Okay, we did that to help ourselves to plow the field, to win the war. That was our car. Then the saddle was born to support the rider better and distribute the load on the horse's back. But for 4,500-year man-made saddles for men, since 1978, the majority of the riders are ladies. And I have shown you with the videos, with the books, with science, with drawings, with taking butt impressions, over 100 butt impressions we took from taller lady, smaller lady, bigger, skinnier lady. So we have it all there so that we can actually say, wow, these doctors really know what they're talking about. It's true. There is a difference between a male and a female. And if I, as a master saddler, as a saddle fitter, or as a manufacturer or tack shop, ignore that, then I purposely hurt the clients, because this is facts. Facts is they have disc problems, they have curvature, they have spinal issues, soft tissue issue, and joint damage. All right, so what I recommend strongly, that everybody gets measured. This is a slide I borrow from Saddle Fit for Life. Saddle Fit for Life, again, is our educational company. My goal was to help people worldwide. Measure around your hip, measure your upper leg, lower leg, measure from hip, like I demonstrate right there. You can do it standing, or best is on the stand with your stirrup leathers. Because this measurement here, you see on the top right, where my mouse goes up and down, obviously changes if you go in the jumping saddle, okay? And then we're going to look at the height of this. If you look down further here, down there, height and weight. Why is weight so important? Well, the seat, your weight, is your most important aid to the horse, okay? So if we look at some riders here, we have some riders here. We got two females. They are pretty much the same, 5'5" and 5'4", with different weight. Okay, so that tells me that the weight-bearing surface on the saddle. Let me show you what that means. So when we measure the horse, sorry, the rider, we check all this fit to the rider, the seat, the flap length, the angulation. Remember the angulation, how I showed you that the femur comes out differently on the female pelvis than on the male pelvis? Okay, so that's important. But here, number 17. Okay, so when I go to number 17 right there, weight bearing surface. Okay, so based on the rider's weight, we determine how narrow or wide the pelvis and how soft the tree needs to be. Also on number 19, the saddle rigidity. The saddle comes with different spring steel, okay? I can make a saddle super flexible for super soft and light riders, but when somebody like me with my 200 pounds go on the saddle, obviously I need stronger spring steel so that the weight gets distributed better, okay? So the weight is important. So not just because there's a male and female, because right here we got a very tall guy. Look at this guy, 5'9", but his weight is only 155 pounds. I'm 6'3", okay, taller than him, 4 inches, but I'm 200 and some pounds, right? So I can choose, do I ride like a 400 pound rider or do I ride like a 100 pound rider? Do I have a pliable seat or rigid seats? So then I look at the circumference right here where it says E, okay? So we got 36 and 42, same height, these two ladies, 1 inch difference, but one person has wider seat bones, okay? The upper leg and the lower leg ratio A and B is reversed on those people, those two ladies. That tells me one of the lady needs the stirrup bar further forward, and the other lady needs the stirrup, this is an extended stirrup bar further back. This has nothing to do with your ability, how good you ride or bad you ride, if you're an Olympian or a pleasure rider, this has something to do with physics, okay? So these measurements, okay, they help tremendously, tremendously. And then people say, oh, why do you need to measure my thigh? Well, the circumference of the thigh, it's a very important measurement because see this edge here, this blue edge, and this edge, this distance here, okay? Your thigh has to fit in between that area. Okay? So some companies have this already built in, but the distance from this point to that point, if you divide a circle through pi, you get the diameter. And if you have to have a leg what swings freely and not get hit in the cantle or hit in the front, then what you want is the saddle what has enough room for your thigh. So the thigh measurement, it's really, really important to fit a quiet leg and that leg hangs underneath you. So these measurements will help your saddle fitter tremendously. So one more time, the weight gives me a good indicator how soft the tree or rigid the tree in my case needs to be. We have different spring steel. The upper leg and lower leg ratio gives me the stirrup bar position or, and of course, the flap length, okay? And then, of course, D, hang on, C, that's all the way down here. With A, B, and C, I can easily figure out how forward the flap needs to be angled for jumping, general purpose, dressage saddle, okay? So this is just a very quick way how we've been taught as master saddlers, when we make custom saddle or when we pick a saddle, what is already built for you, what fits your dimension. These are mainly your bones as well as your muscle what we measure. And then we compare those measurements, gender here, male or female, to all these, okay? There are 15 points that have to fit. They have to fit you. If the saddle doesn't fit the rider right here, saddle fit to rider, your horse will suffer pain. I really cannot emphasize this enough. Okay, so many, many people, such as Wolfgang Meyerhofer, the guy here in the middle, as well as Christian Pam, this is one of the most educated professors when it comes to saddle fit I've ever met. His research is outstanding. And Christian Meyerhofer, Christian Pam, myself, we've done a back symposium. It was fascinating what I learned. And I think this is what the whole purpose is of this webinar, that we learn from each other and Saddle Fit for Life. I'm going to do a little bit advertising quick before we open it up for questions. It's an association what is worldwide. Here we have coming up in August 22nd, huge symposium, and Heuschmann is talking on that as well. And he is a veterinarian, but he talks mainly how you ride. And as we said, well, I said in the beginning of my webinar, a good rider has a pliable seat because a good rider forms a horse. That's a book from Udo Berger, early 1900s. Even jockeys recognize if you're quiet in the saddle, you don't interrupt the rhythm of the breathing, the horse has the chance to perform better and doesn't have to have so fast accidents. So I'm delighted to say a Saddle Fit for Life, we travel the world on 5 different continents. Here we are in Sao Paulo in Brazil. Veterinarians do thermography. Here we are in England with Sue Dyson. And my book last November or December actually won the best educational book at the film festival in Kentucky. Suffering in Silence, and my book in German right here, The Silent Killer. I'm very proud of that. I published that in 2012, and it's in many, many different universities and saddle fitting schools, because it's written with more than just me. There's other authors, saddle historians, veterinarian, farrier, what has farrier to do with saddle fitting? Oh my God, you know, the farrier can exactly see how crooked you or your saddle sits. So I urge everybody, please come and check us out on Saddle Fit for Life Academy. Become the general, become the master, and understand more how saddle should fit you and the horse, and you don't have nasty surprises how saddles hurt you or the horse long term. So at this stage, I'd like to thank you so much for putting this webinar, and I'm opening now, Mary Claire, this webinar for question and answers. Thank you very much.
Fantastic, Yafin. It kind of sounds a little bit sad because it's only one person clapping, but I'm sure we're all clapping in our homes. Thank you so much for that wonderful lecture. That was fantastic. And it was so great to see everybody's comments throughout. So thank you so much for tuning in, everybody. Let's start with the questions. And just before we start, actually, we also have a Saddle Fit, another lecture tomorrow, happening tomorrow, under Saddle Fit for Life. So if you guys would like to join us for that one as well, I believe that's also a free lecture that you can join. The link will be in the description for that as well. So let's take the first question here. And it is, should we assume that we have a male saddle? How do we tell as someone far from a saddle fitter, a master saddle fitter?
Okay, so I'm going to jump out of this program and I'm going to make this a little bigger so I can find and borrow some slides from Saddle Fit for Life here, what I use. So bear with me. The straight answer is yes, unless the person who sold you the saddle asks you, do you want this model as a male or female saddle? So if the person did not know if it's male or female saddle, or just assumed it, let's look at this slide here. Okay, I had a little video here earlier. It was very fast, I admit. But in general, number one, the seat seaming, okay? If you get two fingers in between the seat seaming, it's very, very narrow. That is typical made for a male because that creates that pointy crotch seat. So the male parts go left and right. You also see the number two right there. It feels like the saddle feels, there's a lot of saddles between your upper inner thighs. And then if you look at number three, if that measurement is below 8 inches, okay, smaller than 8 inches, most likely that's a male saddle. Okay, if the area here, the back, number three, is above 8 inches, in general, a female saddle, unless you are a female, there's a couple female saddles who have no hips, they're very straight. Okay, but I guarantee you, these females still have a birth channel. Okay. They might not have extremely wide hips, but they still have a birth channel, which means this area here for all ladies should be a minimum of 3, if not 4 fingers, ladies' fingers. Like my 4 is probably a lady's hand width. So 4 ladies' fingers between where one is, the narrowest area here. Okay. So a female saddle, looking from the side, most of the time has a little higher cantle and more support behind your butt. Right here again, you see a slide. The guys, straighter lower back, butt cheek lower to the horse. An average girl has more curvature and her bottom higher. If you say, no, but I'm straight then, I have no butt, or of course we have the norms, okay? I'm talking in general terms. So that was an excellent question. In general, you end up with a male saddle.
Awesome. Thanks, Yafin. So the next one is from Jess, and it is there anything that those of us with a male saddle can do to improve our saddle fit, or do we have to buy female saddles?
Okay, so if you look at the, let me see if I find a better picture. Oh, that'll do. This here. If we look at the picture on the top left on this screen here, okay, so if I have a saddle, what is the opposite, right? There is 9 different features on a male saddle versus the female saddles. So if you fix one thing, give an analogy with the car, okay? The car has 4 tires, and all 4 tires are flat, right? So if you just pump one tire up, it's better, but it's still not a good ride in the car, okay? You still have 3 tires are flat. So maybe not such a good analogy, but I always, always, always go back to say, horses don't know how to lie. Look at the horse's mouth, look at the horse's ears. You know, they say it what it is. And if we learn from our masters, if the rider sits in the saddle like a Tai Chi person. So when you stand with your hands in front, okay, that's a Tai Chi stand, slightly bent, legs apart, right? You have a very solid stand. And if you just turn your hand sideways, like I just did, except lower, just doing it so making sure you see him, right? That's the rider, right? So look at the rider down here. It's a standing seat. Why is it so important that you have a standing seat? Because I cannot emphasize this enough. You gotta have the ability to sit neutral. Neutral means that this is level and pivot back and forth. If only one of those 9, I'm sorry, ladies, but if only one of the 9s are wrong, you will have a cramped seat and everything goes wrong. Okay, and to the part where the saddles, look at the top right picture here where my mouse is. See how the saddle, after it's been ridden, all the saddle is shifted to the right. The big question comes, if the saddle crooked because the horse was lame, and then the saddle fell there, is the horse lame because the rider hammered on the back? Or is the saddle crooked and the horse became lame because the saddle became crooked because the rider falls off the seat, okay, because it has no seat points. So, unfortunately, my recommendation, rip the bandit off fast, right? In other words, get rid of the saddle and get yourself a female saddle. If you go in the store and says, I want to have a pair of jeans where the left leg is for a male and the right leg is for the female, the clerk will say, the salesperson says, what? So the same thing in the saddle industry. Okay, you can't have half here and half here, right? So my recommendation, if you are a lady, buy yourself a female saddle.
Awesome. Thanks, Yahan. Okay, so we have one last question here. If I'm a female rider and not in pain in a generic saddle, does that mean I'm not using my seat correctly?
The cool part is, and I always say that no pain is already bingo. That's where everything starts. But we also have to understand our body protects ourselves before the real pain starts. See, little children who start to ride, and they ride all year long in the wrong saddle, the body will adopt. Give you an analogy with shoes, okay? You, let's say, have a big family with 10 kids, and not everybody gets their own pair of shoes. So some kids have to wear other kids' shoes, and their foot gets a bunion. That little kid doesn't have any pain. That kid, what grows up to be an adult, has no pain. All of a sudden, after 30 years, she turns 40, she gets knee, hip, all kinds of problems because of foot deformity, what caused from the shoe. For riders who have no pain, okay, could be 2 answers. Number one, your body is in a holding frame, cramped seat, and you somehow manage to manage your pain and or somehow formed without feeling the pain, okay, it will catch up with you. Or you have indeed a pliable seat. And here's how you find it out. Take your cell phone, have somebody else videotape, and see when you ride, does your ankle and your knee swing with the movement? Do you see how your heel goes down rather up when you ride? Is your shoulder, hips, and heel one line? Are you riding with your head over your shoulders, or you're riding like this? That doesn't cause pain. But obviously something, the pressure is now making your head bobbly. So my question to you is, does the video, put it on slow motion, look like you have a pliable seat? All the motion is through your seat, not through your head. And is your hands are quiet and you have a shoulder, hips, and heels? If that's the case and you're not in pain, wow, good for you. You have a good saddle and you don't have to worry about it. If you don't like what you see on the video, your head is bobbling, your head do all kinds of things, your knees and toes are outside, that pain will catch up with you later, but eventually your body cannot hold it. And that's the quotation of Dr. James Walsh, not mine. Okay?
Awesome. Thank you so much, Stefan. And thank you to everybody for joining us. We just posted a special offer for Elisa's group in the Crowdcast chat, so check that out if you haven't already. And thank you to everybody for joining us also on our social media. This was fantastic. Thank you, Stefan, for doing this with us.
Thank you. So I'm going to try. I'm not the biggest techie here, so I'm going to see if I can sign out here. And I'd like to also thank everybody. And I look forward, Mary Claire, to talk to you next Thursday again.
Yeah, join us next Thursday, everybody, for another Ask Yafin. We do live streams every Thursday.
Bye, everybody. Thanks, that was great. Thank you.